Welcome back, fellow agents. It is I, X7, your literary giant of something. Well, the host of Zenorama, the podcast of heroes and monsters, and also the editor, publisher, and writer for Zenorama, the Journal of Heroes and Monsters. About 6 months ago, a little over 6 months ago, we reviewed this book. It was an audio only back then, so you didn't get to see all the lovely, lovely illustrations by Herbert Buell. The Shy Stegosaurus of Cricket Creek is about two teenagers, well, preteens, Joey and Joan Brown, who discover and make friends with a Stegosaurus that they name George. He likes the name George. He knows he's a Stegosaurus. We've been through this. However, now, about a month, well, a while ago, maybe 2 months ago, I got the sequel. So, this was published in 1955 by Evelyn Sibley Lampman, who has a remarkable career. George there. The book itself was republished in, I want to say, by the Purple House Press, who moved from Texas to somewhere else, I think Georgia maybe. The copyright was renewed by her daughter, Linda Lampman McIsaac. This version was published. Come on, where does it say it was published? Guys, don't do this to me. Well, I thought it was on here. I looked it up and now I've forgotten. 1953, 1983, first edition, well, draft, fat rats, as Holly would say. I got it about 10 or 15 years ago, a gift from my sainted mother. This one, the sequel, I do have two. If you look at the original episode from way back in March 4th, episode 60, I believe, let me take a quick peek here. And we'll find out. Scroll. Yes, episode 60. So it's now, really is episode 70, episode 60 of season 2. And now we're at episode 268. So almost 200 episodes later, we're reviewing this second one. And this one, again, was written by Evelyn Sibley Lampman. But it was not illustrated by Mr. Buell. It was illustrated by Paul Galdone, although he does a fantastic job of pretty much looking exactly like the first one. You wouldn't know it. It is called The Shy Stegosaurus of Indian Springs, which is nowadays more possibly an unfortunate name. But back in, this was published, 1962. This book itself was published again in 2023. So it took 10 years at least, if not longer, for them to re-release the sequel. And it's pretty much the same book, except not. I mean, the same. It's a similar story, but our hero this time is Huck, a native Indian boy. He lives with his grandfather. Great-grandfather, something's happened to his grandfather and his parents, lives on an Indian reservation, Native American reservation in Oregon. And he didn't really have many friends because, you know, his grandfather was old and set in his ways, preserving the old ways. And then he meets George. And he also meets Joan and Joey, who are on vacation up there with their aunt. So, and then they finally figure out, Joan and Joey finally figure out, they want to know why Huck is interested in dinosaurs, and then they realize he's met George, and then so it's very cute. I mean, there's some older boys that antagonize Huck because his real name in his language, which I'm sorry I didn't look up, means huckleberry, so they call him Huck if they translate it. He's going to shoot George. He'd have to hit him directly in the eye to even manage to hurt him. Because he doesn't know anything about dinosaurs. He tried to tell people he saw them. The twins were smart enough. He didn't even wonder why. Nobody wonders why this animal can talk. It's really, you know, I don't know. This has to be in eastern Oregon where it's flatter and not, you know, the sun comes out. So it's oh, it's a lovely illustration here. George, they teach George how to Indian wrestle. And I don't even, for the longest time, I thought that was a different thing because I only read this book once or twice. Mom read it, my sainted mother read it to us, my brother and I. This is my bookmark. I got this from Time Warp Comics in, when it was in Longmont, or when they had a store in Longmont. The Fantastic Four. Essential. Volume 3, maybe? Yeah. But be that as it may, I digress. The books they had at the library were shorter and thicker. They were like this. But I'm sure they were still the same illustrations, but these larger ones just really make them look nice. I didn't remember Huck, or that must be Joan, having, you know, I didn't remember any of the illustrations from this one. It took a long time for me to get this. And this is probably the second time I read it. The first one I read maybe twice, but since I've had this one quite some time, I've read it a couple times, and even my sainted mother has. I don't think she's read this one yet. It's an easy read. I mean, it's 200 pages tops, a little over 200 pages, but it's, you can see the prose, the type is quite large, and it has a much happier ending than the last one, because Stegosaurus hibernate, apparently. He calls them sleeps. George is a little more petulant in this one. He comes across as a little whiny on occasion. There's a big big festival of the berries, of picking the berries, and much to do about that. There's no real villains in here like there were in the last one. The two dinguses that were bothering Huck get their comeuppance in a fun way. Nothing that's gonna, well, maybe they're scarred for life by seeing a teepee move. George hides in a teepee. But it just flows really nice. I mean, the characters are nice. Even the two little jerks, they're all right. They're just, you know, teenagers. I mean, hopefully they, when they grow up. I would assume, you know, George is probably 130 million years old and possibly slept through a lot of the ice ages and such, you know, that happened while he was moving about. And he traveled from Wyoming to Oregon, you know, and then, you know, from 1955 to 1962, is that what I said? Took her. So you assume he'd been there for maybe a couple years, and nobody saw him. So, and who's going to stop him? But he couldn't have made it in a year, maybe? I don't know. I think he would have had to do a sleep at some point, because you got to cross mountains there, depending on what side of Oregon or Wyoming he was on. And having been there, this kind of ties into my journey up to Wyoming. Not this one, but the previous one. So I highly recommend this book. They're really nice additions, and I'm happy to have the habit and be able to read it again. But I think those are the two little jerks. Let's see. Click-a-tat. I don't know if that is an actual Native American tribe or if she just made it up. Let's find out here. So Evelyn herself was born in 1932. She was born in April 18th, making her an Aries, 1907, and died January 13th, 1980, at the age of 73. So relatively young these days. Click. Oh, it is Click-a-tat, an incorporated Washington. There's a river, so this is a real place. I should really look up and see if it's a county there. So yeah, it definitely looks like that. If Cricket Creek is a real place, I mean, we know Cripple Creek's a real place because that's where you find it. So yeah, well, cool. So I'm assuming that's probably was a real language. So good for her. Part of her works were about Native Americans and the kids being educated as I hate to say white kids, but she did address these things. She wrote a lot of books. The Witch Doctor's Son, I mean, Navajo Sister, Rusty's Spaceship. Just some interesting titles. It'd be kind of fun to read these. The Bounces of Cynthia Ann. That one, that just sounds funny. Sorry. She also wrote under different names. She had pseudonyms that she would use. Jane Woodland and Lynn Bronson. Her daughters have these, or maybe her granddaughters even. Pardon me. At the copyright, they've renewed them. So I'm glad that they came to their, they came to an agreement to get these done. So, let's see, I'm just trying to see one or two novels a year. She was not afraid to tackle sensitive or even controversial subjects in her novels. Now, she did not, head on, didn't turn this into this fantasy book into a social book at all. Just mentions it. Let's see. Native American, re-education of Native American children, racial tensions. I'm reading this off Wikipedia. Racial tensions, child marriage, changing cultures, and migrant workers. Now, some of these I haven't read about. Apparently, The Bounces of Cynthia Ann was about the orphan bounce children who traveled the Applegate Trail. She's a good writer too. She's engaging, and even with like the little jerks, like I said, they don't get out of hand. They're mean, but they're ignorantly mean, as opposed to, they probably learned better. I found growing up that the people I thought were more unpleasant have been super, as adults have been, either they've realized it or they've realized, we're all pretty much the same. Listen to me get all sensitive and socially oriented. So that is the book. You can buy it on Amazon. You can buy it at the purplecowpress.com. I got this one, I think, from Thrift Books. So, they're good for kids. The science is a little outdated, and you still got to question why there's a 135-million-year-old, and I'm just guessing, Stegosaurus was around 130 million years ago. So there's more distance between us and the Stegosaur, or the Stegosaur and T-Rex than us and the T-Rex. I know that's pretty common, but, can't get around without mentioning a T-Rex now, can I? And he likes his hot, salty mineral water and eats sagebrush. They could still use him in Wyoming. I can tell you that there's a lot of sage out there. Not nearly enough stegosaurs. But I'm assuming he's a Stegosaurus stenops. They were the biggest ones, and that's the most common variety. No, Colorado State fossil. So agents, that's our book review for today. I hope you've enjoyed it. And until our next assignment, this is X7. Oh, I left out all of the fun stuff. You didn't grab nobody wants to grab a big old stack of sage cakes except George, but could have eaten a wheat cake. And did you like, share, subscribe, vote in a poll, and leave a comment? And once again, if you're watching on YouTube, please watch for a little longer. You probably haven't heard that if you've turned it off by now, because we're at the end of the show. So until our next assignment, this is X7 signing off.